بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We begin once again by the mentioning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace and His blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thank you all, jazakumullah khair, for coming back to your seats. I also noticed there's a brother assigned for the door, so may Allah grant you Jannah. And may Allah make you the first person that goes to Jannah with the Prophet ﷺ. There's a first group. May Allah make you of that group. Ameen. So with that being said, brothers and sisters, we stopped the last time of a revelation that never happened before. This was the first time such command was revealed. Then now you can fight back those who fight you. Now that you can push back against the ones who oppressed you. No one will negate that. No one has issues with that. That's just the norm. Especially now, focus with me. May Allah grant you Jannah. Because in these sessions, this one, next one, and some of Medina, some people will have a field day, cutting parts of the video, posting it online, look what he's preaching, this and that. So we ask Allah to grant us strength and wisdom. Say Ameen. So when we talk about things of that sort, about fighting, etc., and being physical, this was a time where there's a Muslim state, a Muslim ruler, there's a leadership level. They are no longer a minority that have no leader in a way, no nation, unlike Mecca. They were a minority. We are more now like Mecca or Medina. Are we more like Abyssinia, the believers there, or Medina? We're more like Mecca and Abyssinia, in a way much more than Medina. So we cannot apply some rules at our time. Not that they are to be deleted, no. To stay until there's a time where they are to be applied. That's how things work. May Allah protect us. But we will learn so much, inshallah, from what will happen very soon. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brothers and sisters, he hears about a caravan for Abu Sufyan, a trade caravan. Who is Abu Sufyan? Explain. Abu Sufyan is one of the top enemies and leaders of Quraysh. He took part in the oppression. He took part in the torture of the believers. He was fully approving of this. Brothers and sisters, Abu Sufyan is coming from north down south. From north, from Asham to Syria today approximately, to back to Mecca. What does that mean? When he goes south, he has to pass by which city? Medina. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we gotta say sallallahu alaihi wasallam as much as we can, inshallah. So the Prophet sallam, he hears about that, and he tells his companions. This is very important. He tells his companions, "Hada Abu Sufyan. This is Abu Sufyan and his trade caravan. Let's go and take over the enemy. Perhaps Allah will bestow the blessings on us." And he also said, "I want whoever is ready right now to go with me. We're not waiting for no one." So it's either you're ready or you're not. So the believers, some of them were ready. It's right here. They got whatever, body armor. They got their weapon. They got their ride. Some companions said, "Oh, Prophet of Allah, can I just go like pick up my stuff? It's like quite a distance, a few minutes or so," or whatever the case may be. The Prophet said, "La." No, only the ones who are what? Ready. The Prophet ﷺ is not anticipating a full-fledged war. That's what's the expectation. Ready? The expectation, the Prophet ﷺ and the team members, the companions, will come to the trade caravan. Trade caravan does not have a large number of security guards. They're not equipped for war. So they will come, scare them away, Abu Sufyan, scare him away, then take over some of that wealth, just maybe a portion of what they were robbed of all these past 13 plus years. A plan. The Prophet ﷺ, how was the condition of the Muslims? 20% of the army of the believers were from the refugees, the immigrants that came from Mecca. And 80% of them were from the supporters, those who lived where? In Medina. Fantastic. A total of approximately 317 Muslims. And how were their rides and equipment? Very, very humble. Very humble. But they took the means. What was the case? Three men for every camel. Allahu Akbar. Three men for every camel. That's how few rides they had. So you're telling me they're walking towards them? Some of them, yes. Did the Prophet have his own, right? No, he did not. He shared his ride. Who were the two other brothers? Who were the two blessed brothers? Ali bin Abi Talib and Abu Lubaba. May Allah be pleased by both of them. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would sit. Abu Lubaba sits. And Ali, and they take turns. When the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was sitting on the camel, his time was up. He needs now to switch with the next person. Ali and Lubaba agreed that let's pass our turn and keep it with the Prophet. So we will walk the entire way. Let the Prophet sit the whole way. Alayhi salam. So when the turn came to an end, Ali, Abu Lubaba said, "O Prophet of Allah, stay on the camel, stay in the camel, we will walk." The Prophet said to them two things. Number one, he says, "None of you two are stronger than me and can handle walking." Allahu Akbar. Yes, basically you may be younger, but you're not stronger. You have to appreciate. This is a battle, right? But we take lessons, and there's lesson after lesson. Every point we can extract something. Every word the Prophet ﷺ says, you can get fruits from it, yes? What do I take from it? There's a lot that can be taken. How old is the Prophet ﷺ? How old? About 55 years old. And he's telling people a lot younger than him, "I'm perhaps stronger than you," right? Yes, Allah blessed him. But this comes to show you how he took care of his body. He ate healthy. He was conscious about his diet. One hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, out of all the containers in the world, this is a container, right? They have other containers. Out of all the containers in the world, the worst container to fill is your stomach. That's what he said. And now we learn, whether it's experience or science, I was reading an article from a dietitian from MD Anderson, saying how when you eat so much and you overeat, your stomach size expands. I actually never knew that. Now it makes sense. Like, how was I able to eat this? Now I know. May Allah forgive us. Say ameen. May Allah allow us to change our diet habits. So when you eat so much, the stomach expands, and the research says, and the organs are being pushed. The lungs, excuse me, we need to eat, okay? Okay, the heart, it don't matter, right? Just kick it away. What about the instantan, whatever the case may be, Einstein, just go away, right? The whole thing, and then you expand. The science shows that you become sleepy, you become drowsy, and it says the word sluggish. You can tell that's not my word, right? It says the word sluggish, and it just messes up your sleep as well. May Allah forgive us and protect us. So the Prophet advises you, don't you ever overeat, and don't you fill your stomach with food. May Allah grant us wisdom and being able to appreciate things. Amin Rabbil Alameen. So he says, I am stronger than the both of you. You guys are not stronger than me. The second thing he said, and I am not in any lesser need of the reward. You guys want to walk to get the reward of helping the Prophet. I too want to get the reward of helping my companions. I also want the reward to walk to the battle and be just and be fair. And look how the Prophet ﷺ, who is promised Jannah, he still sought avenues for reward. So if this was the case of the one who's guaranteed Jannah, he does not belittle an opportunity of a good deed, then what about you and I? Yes or no? But obviously, prioritize things. May Allah grant us wisdom. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look what he said. A man one time was walking. He saw a tree branch on the ground. He looked at the tree branch. He picked it up so that people don't trip from it, do not fall because of it. He picked it up. No one recognized him. Perhaps no one saw him except Allah. What was the reward of the tree branch that many people walked by and said, really, that reward, I'm going to go do this and go do that instead? The Prophet said, Allah thanked him for that. Allah granted him Jannah because of that. Allahu Akbar. Do not belittle any opportunity of good deed and make sure you prioritize things. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. May Allah grant us wisdom. So this is what he said, and they continued their journey. Now, Abu Sufyan, the enemy, the leader of the caravan, he is aware that the Muslims are now on the hunt against him because he is also waging war. So he sends his scouts, brothers and sisters, and the enemy's reaction They hear that the Muslims are coming their way. Oh boy. Abu Sufyan gets shocked. They're coming to a location called Badr. Badr is where there's a well, a water well. Many times people go through during their trips to drink water from it. So most likely Abu Sufyan will pass by that location. Once Abu Sufyan hears the Muslims are coming, he sends what? A warner to Mecca. Go talk to people of Mecca that I need help. So that warner comes to Mecca, tells the Quraysh, come, Al-Latima, Al-Latima. What is that? Your trade caravan? I don't know if you'll make it or not. The Muslims are coming to attack it. Who spoke? The Pharaoh of Ummat Muhammad. The Pharaoh of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam era was who? The worst, the most evil, Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl said, Adriku irakum, go protect your caravan. He focused on the caravan. Abu Sufyan, doesn't matter. Right? The money, right? Protect the caravan, your money, your wealth. So they all got suited up, brothers and sisters, and they got all ready for a full-fledged war. By the armor, horses, camels, etc. Now, Abu Sufyan, and he was intelligent in terms of fighting techniques, in terms of the mapping and his scouts and his network skills, he was able to do what? To bypass the Muslims. So if the Muslims were here, Abu Sufyan is coming down south, does not want to meet them. So he comes down south, finds his way, bypasses the believers, and then he comes to where? Mecca. On his way, after he bypassed and dodged away from the Muslims, he sent what? He sent Abu Sufyan a message to the army of Quraysh. The army of Quraysh with Abu Jahl is on their way, correct? So now Abu Sufyan says, no, you're all set, we're all good. Caravan is safe, your money's safe, I'm coming back. So the army said, that's awesome, there's no need to fight. They want to go back. But who spoke? Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl said, I swear to God we're not going back. Why? Is that why you care about your money? It's back. He says, I swear to God we're not going back. Abu Jahl insists to fighting the Muslims. He said, I swear to God we're not going back. We will go to Badr. And we will do whatever we gotta do. We will have a feast and celebrate. And this is his words. And he said, we'll go there and have food and stuff. And he said, we let the ladies go ahead and sing. And we will enjoy our nights. So all the Arab can know, don't you ever mess with us of Quraysh. So all the Arab can know to think twice before facing us. How much of the army was convinced? How influential is Abu Jahl? The majority of the army stayed behind. May Allah forgive us and protect us. May Allah make us people of influence with that which is positive but not negative. Brothers and sisters, upon this, the Prophet ﷺ also has his scouts, yes or no? And he got the news. What was the news? Two things. The caravan is gone. Quraysh is coming to kill you all. The Prophet ﷺ is not ready for war. What does he do? The Prophet seeks counsel and advice from the companions. He says, Ashiru alayhi ayyuha nas. Oh brothers, oh believers, oh people, give me advice. What should we do? We are 317, three men sharing a camel, hardly have anybody armor. Out of the whole army, there's only one horse, which is belonging to Al-Miqdad. So just to give you a feel, just an example, it's like someone has a car, so old, so slow, the check engine light is on, the tires barely have any air, and then some guy with the fastest, newest car wants to race. What should we do? What's your advice? What's the plan? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq stands up and says motivational remarks. We're with you, and so on, and so forth. The Prophet ﷺ appreciated that, and then Abu Bakr sat down. But the Prophet kept the floor open. Why would he do that? No one is raising their hands. No one is speaking up. So it seems everybody agrees to what Abu Bakr is saying, correct? He says, people, come on. I want suggestions, thoughts. Ashiru alayhi, come on, talk. Who stands up? Umar al-Khattab. Umar said, Ya Rasulallah. And he gave him encouraging remarks, meaning, go ahead, do your thing, we're with you. We are with you. Appreciates that. Umar sits down. Ashiru alayhi ayyuhannas. What's going on? So companions, perhaps thinking, maybe the Prophet wants to hear more. So Al-Miqdad stands up. He says, O Prophet of Allah, do what you see best to do. Meaning, basically go to war. I and the believers will not tell you what the children of Israel said to Moses. We will not tell you that. The children of Israel, they told Moses when there was a battle, just like this almost, the children of Israel said to Moses, اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنها هنا قاعدون. They said to Moses, you and your Lord, go fight, we're waiting right here till you're done. Al-Miqdad said, we will not say that. We say, go you and your Lord and fight, and we will be to your left and right. Allahu Akbar. And if we had to go all the way to Yemen, he mentioned a location in Yemen, we will go all the way there to Yemen, if that's what it takes. The Prophet appreciated that very much. Al-Miqdad sat down. Ashiru alayhi ayyuha al-nas, give me advice. What's going on? So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, he says, it seems that you want to hear from us. Okay, you need to explain. What do you mean us and who's them and what's going on? Abu Bakr, Umar, Miqdad, where from? Mecca. No one from the original residents of Medina spoke yet. So Sa'd is from the 80%. Who spoke was the 20%. And the Prophet wants to know, alayhi salatu wasalam, because when the supporters in Medina, they gave the pledge of allegiance to support the Prophet the way they protect their wives, their children, their own selves, did not say even outside Medina. So the coverage was city-wide, not nationwide. So the Prophet wants to hear from them. So Sa'd said, I think you want to hear from us. The Prophet said, exactly. He said, Ajal, that's exactly who I want to hear from. What do you say about this? He says, well, O Prophet of Allah, we know that what you say is nothing but the ultimate truth. And we know that it was God who sent you to us. As a result of these testimonies, we believe in you and we hear what you say and we obey. O Prophet of Allah, if what it takes for the mission to be accomplished is for us and for you to jump into the ocean and dive and cross the ocean, we will all dive into the ocean and go after you. مَا تَخَلَّفَ مِنَّا أَحَدٍ. Not one of us from the 80%, not one of us of the supporters will leave you behind. O Prophet of Allah, we're not fearful of the battle tomorrow. No way. Rather, we're truthful to our words. We will fight the enemy with absolute courage. Perhaps, O Prophet of Allah, Allah will help us in a way that will make you happy tomorrow. So, ala barakatillah, with Allah's blessings, proceed, O Rasulullah, do what you see is best. The Prophet was happy. The Prophet was rejoiced. May Allah grant us steadfastness and strength, Ameer Rabbil Alameen. Do you love the Prophet like that? You see what he said? I pray that Allah will help me in a way that will make you happy. Ever thought of that? Do we have a deed in our books of deeds that when we see other Prophet on the Day of Judgment, Ya Rasulullah, I did this, did that make you happy? Are you like that, brothers and sisters? Can we do something like that, inshallah? May Allah grant you peace and be able to establish a good deed in your life. Say ameen. Such a good deed. Such a good deed that when the Prophet sees it, he's so proud of you. May Allah allow us to see Allah where He is also pleased with us. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. So the Prophet says, be optimistic. Be optimistic and let's march. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised me victory. Brothers and sisters, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now is headed to Badr. What was Badr again? What's Badr?
The wells.
The Badr were the wells, correct? That was the area. So the Prophet sallallahu and the believers, what happens? They arrive to Badr. Once they arrive to Badr, they find two of the enemy there. So they run and try to capture them both. The enemy. So one of them fled away and one of them they grabbed. So they asked him what? Kam al-qawm? How big is the army? How big is the army of Quraysh? He says, they're huge. And they're so prepared. They got so angry, they beat him up. Give us a number. Like, brother, why? Where's the gentleness? Okay, sure. I'll give you a disclaimer, inshallah. So we proceed with the momentum, inshallah. And if we stop, it's okay. What's happening here, this is war. Right now, we are in stage not of war. There's maqam da'wah, maqam jihad. There's a stage of jihad, like war, okay, not struggle, it's like jihad straight up, which also means struggle. And there is the stage of what? Nasiha, advice, da'wah, gentleness. Fair enough? The stage of da'wah is what? Kindness in your speech, gentleness with your approach, right? Al-maw'idat al-hasana, correct? Musa alayhi salam was in the stage of da'wah. Pharaoh, the worst man to walk on earth, Allah told Moses and speak to Pharaoh, the one who says, I am God, and he's torturing people and killing babies. That Allah tells him, speak to him gently and be very basically watchful over the words that you choose. Allah didn't tell him, punch him in the face, right? Even though you would love that perhaps to happen, right? But that's maqam da'wah, and that's where we're at. Right? What I'm talking about now in this battle is maqam jihad. What does Allah say? Gentleness? La ya miskeen. Gentleness what? This is war. Right? You're going to go battle with the brothers, inshallah, and the sisters that join. This is battle. You know what Allah says? Ghilza. Be harsh. This is war. So we have to be able to understand these things and not use that excitement and apply it here. This is my hope and optimism, inshallah. We use the energy that when we hear these things, we transfer it to here. How? Bismillah. With that, with da'wah. You become motivated. You want to do something. You want to help the people. You want to help your community. You use that energy from the battles to help you with that. Fair enough? May Allah grant us wisdom. So Rasulullah, he receives the man which the believers caught. They said, Ya Rasulullah, this guy is not responding. So the Prophet asks him, Kam al-qawm, how big is the army? He says, they're big. They're like really big. Like he has like 300. They're bigger, for sure. So the Prophet asks him, how big is their daily meals? Huh? How many camels do they slaughter a day for their food? He said, they slaughter 10 camels. The Prophet said, each camel feeds 100, so the army is over 1,000. And the army is greater than 3 times the army of the believers. Not just quantity, but in terms of the armor quality and the weapons and the horses and this and that. May Allah protect us and grant us wisdom. The believers, they know. The means, we take them, we have our hearts, trust Allah, and victory will come. Brothers and sisters, the night right before Badr, how nervous would you be the night before first job interview ever? How nervous would you be when you have a final examination? How nervous would you be when you have a very important appointment the next day? Sometimes we don't sleep. May Allah grant us safe sleep, Amir Rabbil Alameen, peaceful one. The companions were struggling a little bit. We're struggling with sleep. Tomorrow is not an interview. Tomorrow they may die. Tomorrow they may never see the family. No, worse. Tomorrow they may never see the Prophet ﷺ again. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw in the believers that they took the means. Yes? They're with the Prophet, crossed the ocean, they walked all the way to Badr. They heard the numbers. Did they run away? Did they run? No, they stayed. They know what they have and they stayed. When you take the means and you trust Allah, Allah helps you. So Allah miraculously, إِذْ يُغَشِّيكُمُ النُّعَاسِ, the companions start to feel sleepy. Ah, how was that? Sleepy. Ali ibn Abi Talib says, we're all getting sleepy. Sleepy. And all of a sudden, it's raining. Light rain. Allah. You know, some of us, we put on YouTube the rain sound to, you know, quiet things down, not to have a very nice sleep. This is real rain, customized for the believers. So they fall asleep. Background, rain sound. Ya Allah. Ali ibn Abi Talib says, we went under the trees and under other parts to, we can have sleep and away. Then he says, all of us slept except the Prophet of Allah. He stood up under one of the trees and he kept praying to Allah for success. He made dua. See how dua is an integral component. You see what we're referring to, brothers and sisters? They did the work, they walked, and they walked the talk, all these things, but dua has to come in place. Whenever you do a project, add dua. What do we do sometimes? Exam is coming. Jazakallah khair. You're outside the exam hall. What do? You're so nervous, reviewing. There's 2 minutes left. Yani that 2 minutes will make you get that scholarship. We went through school, we know these 2 minutes mean nothing. To an extent, right? Maybe like one lucky day. You go, put this away. Khalas, you studied. You did? Yes, alhamdulillah. Well, best overnight type of stuff. No, wallah, I studied throughout the semester. Pause. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Ya Allah, help me. Ya Allah, make it easy. Ya Allah, make my parents pleased by me. Ya Allah, I don't know what will happen if I fail. Ya Allah, cry to Allah. Do whatever it is. Battle. We learn it. You see how you take that lesson, you use it. And that's what it takes. May Allah grant us Jannah. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. And the Prophet ﷺ is making dua to Allah for victory. And he says, oh Allah, if these people die, you may possibly never be worshipped on earth again. What? He said, if these people die, you may possibly never be worshipped again. To show the grand companion that showed up. Amongst the companions was Abu Bakr. Amongst him was Umar. Amongst him was Ali. Amongst him was Uthman. No, brother. No. Don't get too excited. What happened? Uthman, I read the seerah, he's not there. No, he's there. I read the book, Uthman stayed in Medina. Because it says that Ruqayya, his wife, was sick. Yeah, that's true. He wanted to join the army, but he was advised to stay. So in the sight of Allah, he is in the army, gets the reward of everyone struggling in the army while he's still at home. He's still at home caring for his sick wife Ruqayya. Allahu Akbar. And Ali ibn Abi Talib was there. And Hamza, and Miqdad, and Ubaidah. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us wisdom and success. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Making dua. And Ali says, we all went to sleep. Who woke them up? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet on the day of the battle. He says, As-salatu jami'ah. It's time to pray. As-salatu jami'ah. Pray what? Dawn time. What? Pray what? Fajr. Allahu Akbar. Ali ibn Abi Talib says, we woke up and we left from under the trees and under other places and we went to go pray. You think I will let this pass by? There is a battle. There's a battle where they may die. The Prophet did not say, masakin, ta'banin, tired, exhausted, there's a battle. Let them miss Fajr. It's okay, there's a battle. You wake up for Fajr, that's how you win the battle. You wake up, pray Fajr, that's how you win the battle. And the day you miss Fajr intentionally is the day you lost the battle. You have an exam, miskin, and that, wallahi, some of us as parents, may Allah protect all of us, and we all have mistakes. We do these shortcomings, we get our son and daughter used to this. You have an exam, how old are you? They're mature, they're each over puberty. It's okay, they have a project. Khalil, let them sleep. May Allah forgive you and guide you. Then when they get older, you start calling other people. Watch what the Prophet did and apply it in your life. May Allah forgive us and ease things on us. For wallahi, it's not so easy. May Allah grant us wisdom. Wake up and pray Fajr. And they all prayed Fajr. After Salah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam motivates the believers with some beautiful narrations. Allahu Akbar. When you go for jihad and you fight for the sake of Allah, you get that reward, and that reward absolutely amazing. He said, قوموا إلى جنة عرضها السماوات والأرض. He's saying that hadith suitable for the occasion. He said, go and stand up and head towards paradise. Bro, they're going to the battle. He's saying, if you die in the battle, you will go to gardens as wide as the heavens and earth. One of the companions, he says, Bakhin, oh boy. The Prophet says, what made you say that? Ya Umair. He says, I wish to have these gardens as wide as the heaven and earth. I wish to have them. The Prophet said, Umair, you'll be one who lives in that. Allahu Akbar. How does he know the unseen? Allah revealed it to him. Brothers and sisters, you like one guy who says, wallahi, why is it so weird? And alhamdulillah, if I have something small in Jannah, and this is too big, wallahi. Me Allah, wallahi, it's true, wallahi. Some people came to me after a lecture one time, saying stuff like that. Ya akhi, realize something. The size of your joy in Jannah is equivalent to the size of your Jannah. The size of your happiness and joy in Jannah is equivalent to your assets in Jannah. So when you go to Firdaus, and then that's the absolute greatest, that's how happy you will be. The Prophet ﷺ says, the lowest level in Jannah, they pass by their assets. This is my house, this is this, these are my rivers, yes, this is my kada, this is this. It takes them 1,000 years. That's the minimum. And the elite, they're the ones who see Allah day and night. May Allah make us of the elite. So Umar says, Bakhin, I wish, and the Prophet says, you will be amongst them. Brothers and sisters, the Prophet ﷺ, he assembles the army. Assemble, line up, straight line, right? Istawu, right? Maybe the enemy is laughing. Sahala, yes or no? Look at these people. One guy standing just has like a small knife, right? And they hardly have any animals. Some people had no body armor. They're like, what are we doing with these kids, right? Right? What are you doing with these people? But these people, the greatest generation ever, they know. We will do what we can. That's the equation of success. What is it? You do what you can. Remember the example of the car? We'll check the fluids. Check what fluid against the Corvette. Check the fluids. Why is that check engine light is on? Try to fix it. What will help you? Actually, I take my part. I do whatever I can. And the rest is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They lined up, brothers and sisters. The Prophet ﷺ had like an arrow, like a stick, making sure everybody's in line, in line, in line. Then you have one companion who is offline, out the line. So the Prophet says, "Istawi ya Sawad, Sawad." So the Prophet did this. Then someone's like, "Oh, awja'tani, you hurt me." The companion's, "You hurt me, ya Rasulullah. You are a prophet who is just. Allah sent you with justice. And I was told that, you know, a hit for a hit. Retribution. This is a battle. Is this authentic? Wallahi authentic. For some reason, Sawad made his clothing in a way that his skin of his stomach is shown. And that's where the Prophet struck Sawad. What did the Prophet do? What would someone else do? This is an army. You're worried about this? You're about to get killed? Right? But that was what some other people may do. The Prophet, he lifted his shirt. He said, "Iqtas, hit me back, Ya Allah." How do you think the 317 feel? Right? He says, "Iqtas, go for it." Then Sawad drops on his knees. He hugs the Prophet and he kisses his stomach. The Prophet said, "What are you doing?" He said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, you see what we are facing. Armies, 1,000 plus horses, armor. And I don't know if I'll ever see you again. And the last thing, if I never see you again, the last thing I would wish for is that my skin touches your skin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to see the Prophet in Jannah, where we have a handshake with him, we embrace him, and we hang out with him, Rabbil Alameen." So when this happened, the Prophet ﷺ prayed for who? For Sawad. He prayed for him. You know what he told him next? "Istawi ya Sawad." Line up, Sawad. Right? That was good. Now line up. Taking the means. Like, you know what? Yes, ala barakat. No, line up. That's ala barakatillah. And brothers and sisters, in the Prophet ﷺ provides the army, what? With instructions. Some of them, he said, when you shoot with the arrows, wait until they come. And when you shoot, shoot with the intention that you will hit. Meaning, we have very few arrows. Not enough for the war. Can you believe that? We have just a few bullets. That's all we have. So when you want to shoot, just make sure it's like a shot that there's a big chance someone's going to get hit by it. They listen. He also said, when we fight, I don't want no one to go in front of me. I want to be the one who leads. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah ﷺ, yes, he did have his operation room in the back of the army, trying to tactic things out and work things out as well. And he gave them the instructions, and they heard and they obeyed. What's next? What would be one of the last things the Prophet does? You have to all know by now. Make dua. You see that? You see that? Make dua. Now, because you do everything you can, Allah, take the wheel from there, right? Ya Allah, lead the way from here. Ya Allah, take care of our affairs. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. He made dua to Allah. Oh Allah, grant me what you promised. Ya Allah, grant me what you promised. Oh Allah, grant me what you promised. He made dua so much so that his shawl, he had like a jacket, a coat, that fell on the floor. That's how desperate he was. It was this high, very high that you can see the Prophet ﷺ underarm. Then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he saw that. The Sahaba saw that. They were so moved at the level of desperation. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq grabs the shawl, puts it on the Prophet's shoulders, gives him a hug from the back. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I think you made enough dua. I think it's sufficient. I think it's sufficient. Allah will fulfill His promise to you. Then the brothers and sisters within the army of the believers are waiting, and then there's something going on with the enemy. What is going on? One of the enemy seeks to stop the war before it starts. What's his name? Utbah bin Rabi'ah. Utbah, one of the elite and the leaders of the enemy. He is talking, and in summary, he is saying, this makes no sense. What in the world are we doing? Meaning, these are some family members. What in the world can these people do to us? That's how confident he was that he will beat them all. He said, makes no sense. You know what I'd say, guys? He's an elite, he's a leader. He said, you know what? I think we should not start that war. I think we should just end it right here. Let's all go back home and blame it on me. Just keep saying, Utbah is a coward. Just say that, Jabuna Utbah. Blame it on me. We go to Mecca, what happened? Utbah was scared. The leader, he told us, go back. Just blame it on me. But you all know I'm not a coward, right? Who heard that? The Pharaoh, Abu Jahl. He says, I swear to God, if someone said that other than you, I would have knocked them out. He said, Utbah, you're a coward. You are a real coward. You are terrified to your core. You're shaken from the inside, Utbah. Utbah got so angry, Utbah said, I will show you who's the coward. Oh, you who all what you care about is food, drink, entertainment, and sleep. I will show you tonight, today, who's the coward, me or you. And guess what? Utbah went from wanting to stop the war to the one who starts the war. And this happens to us in our time and age, yes or no? Remember, learn, apply. A guy is driving. Wallahi, it happened to me. And the guy next to me says, bro, you got this car. It was a rental. Breathe in, breathe out. Okay, expensive car. Driving. And he says, bro, race this car. Race this car. I'm like, bro, it's not right, right? Race this, bro, you got this car. Come on, race this car. And the other car was like a Camaro or whatever, going very fast. Race this car. I'm like, well, you're scared because it's a rental? Huh? You don't have insurance? I'm like, okay, right? And then we went, right? May Allah grant us wisdom. We were younger. Yani, alhamdulillah. Yani, maybe a few days ago. Anyways, alhamdulillah. May Allah grant us wisdom. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. Yes, yes. Alhamdulillah. That was a long, long time ago. Okay? So then we did that. Okay? So this is what happened. Sometimes it happened in your lifetime. Akhi, and this is not something I'm proud of. Wallahi, that's something that is lousy of me. That's a horrible story. That's a horrible example. Horrible. Wallahi, it is. We smiled, we laughed, alhamdulillah. May Allah grant us Jannah. But this would have been a story where you all cried. Perhaps. Or the family of the one whom I could have killed in that driving would have cried. Yes or no? We could have raced and the car would have flipped. And all of us would say, oh, he passed away. How? Don't worry about it. No, how? Drag racing. What a shame. What a shame. Yes or no? So this happens. What happened to Utbah happens to you. Come on, it's okay. Bro, take a... One puff. What, you gonna get cancer? One puff. Then he grabs all the aragil. Right? It happens, right? Take that cigarette. Just one puff. You're gonna die, really? You really believe what's on the package? And then you go all out. And that will happen to adults. Imagine youngsters, right? Maybe a bit overzealous. May Allah grant us wisdom. Say ameen. We learn from the battle. Brothers and sisters, if you guys noticed, we hardly ever talk about battles. Yes or no? Especially in our climate. We need to change that. We're so proud of this. Completely proud of this. We can learn so much of it. Wallahi. Allah, I swear by Allah. What I did not cover is a lot more. 5-10 times more than what I'm covering. You see that? So may Allah allow us to learn the life of the Prophet. Say ameen. Let's go. So Utbah bin Rabi'ah, he calls upon his sibling. Shayba calls upon his son Al-Walid. Look what he does. He brings his brother and son. And they go, and that's how the battle usually starts. It starts with a duel. 3-on-3, 1-on-1. Then, it's like a momentum build-up. Then, you go all out. So then he says, give me 3 from you. 3 from the supporters, Medina, they come. Utbah says, who are you guys? They say, we are people from Medina. He's like, with all due respect, kiram, and respect, I don't want you. I want family. I want Mecca people. I want people who left us. I want blood. شوف الـ evil. May Allah protect us. So they go back. The guy says, Ya Muhammad, ibaath lana akfa'ana, give us someone equivalent to us. The Prophet says, get up, O Ubaidah. Get up, O Hamza. Get up, O Ali. Then they get up, all from Mecca. They're walking towards Utbah, Shayba, Walid. As they get closer, Utbah says, who's this? Hamza says, it's me. You don't want to mess around with Hamza. Ali says, it's me. Ubaidah says, it's me, Ubaidah. And he says, now we're talking, bring it on. So who fought who? As you can see here, Utbah fought Ubaidah, Shayba fought Hamza, and Al-Walid fought Ali, and there might be different narrations, but we'll proceed. Ubaidah struck Utbah, Utbah struck Ubaidah. Both got injured. The first one got injured so bad. Both of them. Hamza and Ali, right away, were able to kill the enemy. And when they were done, they joined Ubaidah, assisted him, and then they were able to finish who? Utbah. Then they carried Ubaidah, and they went all the way to the army, and then he placed them for him to be treated, so on and so forth. Brothers and sisters, and the battle begins. The battle begins. What was the instructions? When they come closer, start shooting the arrow. Did they panic? No. Instructions. We hear and we obey. You might panic. No, listen to the Prophet. Listen. Umar ibn Hammam was waiting, and Abdurrahman bin Auf says something interesting. Abdurrahman bin Auf, he says, we were standing, and the guy next to me, very young man, like one of the youngest, like beginners in the battle, he gives me a sign, he wants to talk to me. Ammi, am, uncle. Abdurrahman bin Auf says, yes. Abdurrahman says to himself, to us, I really did not feel comfortable here because the next to me were younger people, beginners, and usually when you fight, if they die, all three of the enemy will come to me. So he said, I wish I was in a different spot. But he says, the younger guy says, I'm. He's like, what do you want? He said, where's Abu Jahl? Abu Jahl, that's your aim. Abu Jahl, one shot. Right, Abu Jahl, ma turid Abu Jahl. He said, Ya Am, uncle, I heard that he caused pain to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I swear to God, the moment I see him, I will attack him. I will fight him until one of us dies. And I was like, whoa. He says, the one next to me to my left, he gave me, as if they don't want the other to hear, to get the reward of Abu Jahl's killing. Uncle. Naam. Where's Abu Jahl? He's like, you too. Where's Abu Jahl? He said, Abu Jahl? What do you want about Abu Jahl? I don't think he said you too. He said, where's Abu Jahl? So then he said, I heard that he heard the Prophet ﷺ. And I want to go tackle this guy. Beat him up. You beat him up. Yes. Beat him up. You might not believe. That's the iman. I want to go beat him up for what he did to the Prophet ﷺ, until one of us dies. This is because of times that we live in, things may be taken out of context. We'll try to address that a little bit. Some may cut this and say, look what he's doing to the youth. Yes, I want you to be motivated by this. Mu'adh and Mu'awwidh. One was the son of Afra, and the other, I believe, was a Jumahi. Be motivated. Use that energy and go say, I want to give da'wah to that enemy today. You see that? I want to talk to them gently. I want to write letters to them. I want to be able to talk about Islam. I want to be able to learn. Use that energy. No fighting. Because we are in stage of da'wah, not stage of what? Say it together so the camera can hear. Not the stage of fighting. Not the stage of Jazakumullah khair media. Right? Fair enough? So Abdurrahman bin Auf says, this excitement, he says, I would not want to switch my spot no more. Wallahi, he's right. Brothers and sisters, the army is coming, they're closer. Now the arrows start to shoot towards the enemy. And they're fighting. Allahu Akbar. Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, phenomenal job. Al-Miqdad, Allahumma barik. Ali bin Abi Talib, the disbelievers are shocked. Like, how is this happening? How are we losing? How are they more motivated than us? How is that possible? They're dying one after the other until Abdurrahman bin Auf, who does he spot? Abu Jahl. So he tells the ones next to him, he's fighting, Abu Jahl is right there. And they went as fast as falcons to go fight Abu Jahl, the one who's so strong, so big. The Prophet prayed for his guidance. How influential Abu Jahl is. He sees these two younger beginners coming. Wallahi, they may be beginners, but the one who's helping them is Allah Al-Khabir, the All-Knowing. They come and they start want to fight Abu Jahl. Ikrimah, the son of Abu Jahl, comes to help out. And the both were able to kill Abu Jahl. Allahu Akbar. You're hearing it today. You might not feel it like the believers. You know what does Abu Jahl mean, that he's dead? You know what does that mean? After 15 plus years of torture, The last 2 years they were in Medina. Of all what he did to the believers, of the Abu Jahl wanting to step and crush the head of the Prophet, remember? Abu Jahl, the one who enticed the people to choke the Prophet to death, remember? Abu Jahl who told Uqba, throw the waist of the camel on the Prophet while he's praying, remember? Abu Jahl, after all the corruption, Abu Jahl, the one who made this war continue, yes or no? He's now dead by two younger men. They went to the Prophet to celebrate for the sake of Allah. Ya Rasulullah, we killed Abu Jahl. The Prophet was happy. The other guy said, no, I killed him. No, I killed him. Competing for reward. So the Prophet said, did you clean your swords? They said, no. So they showed the sword to the Prophet. He said, both of you killed Abu Jahl. Allahu Akbar. They fought. One of the companions got killed. Umair. Umair ibn al-Hammam. Who said, Bakhin, oh boy. He got killed. But alhamdulillah, the believers are winning. Brothers and sisters, with Abu Jahl dying, the enemy is still fighting. Allah saw the support. Allah saw the means being taken. Now, what happened? A strong wave of wind appeared. The enemy is still large. The enemy is still effective. Ali ibn Abi Talib says, one very strong wave of wind came. Then the next one came, stronger than the first one. Something I've never seen before. Then a third wave came. What in the world is that? The Prophet ﷺ, when he saw that, he says, جَاءَكُمُ النَّصْرُ. Victory has come. These are angels that Allah sent from the heavens to help us out. And wallahi, Allah will send help to you. But when we are real men and women that take the means. Are you guys with me? No help is coming the way. Don't complain about Allah until you do the work and you put the effort. Allah's help will be right on the way, inshallah. The angels, they come. One narration says, a companion was fighting with someone. All of a sudden, the guy just falls dead. What was that? It was an angel who fought on his behalf. Allahu Akbar. Another companion says, I was running after one of the enemy. All of a sudden, I heard someone saying, Aqdim Hayzum. Go ahead, Hayzum. Who's Hayzum? Go ahead, Hayzum. A guy on a horse coming and killing the enemy. So this companion says, what? Just who's? What's this? So he went to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, like I'm seeing things. Like what's? A guy says, Aqdim Hayzum. The Prophet said, you have said the truth. That was an angel from the third heaven. Allahu Akbar. How do you think they feel? Allah sadaqana wa'dah. Allah fulfilled His promise. Allah promised you, work hard, I'll give you victory. That's what Allah said. And the Muslims were victorious one after the other until the enemy fled away. Abu Jahl is dead. Utba is dead. And they're all gone back to Mecca. The first one to arrive to Mecca, the first one, they said, so how was the battle? What happened? He said, Abu Jahl is killed. Utba is killed. Umayyah ibn Khalaf, the one who tortured Bilal, got killed. Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah got killed. So one of the people, the son of the leader who did not join the battle, he said, this guy lost his mind. It's not possible. It's not logical in any way, shape or form, never seen in history. How is it possible? So he said, his name was Safwan ibn Umayyah. He said, tell this guy who came, where is Safwan? Maybe he'll tell you he died too. So they asked him, so okay, and what happened to Safwan? He said, Safwan is right here. And I saw his dad and brother getting killed. Could not comprehend. How is it possible? Brothers and sisters, the believers stay 3 days in the battlefield. And before they left, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam spoke to the dead people from Quraysh. He did not call them name by name. He called them full name by full name. He says, Ya Utba bin Rabi'a. Ya Shayba bin Rabi'a. Ya Abu Jahl ibn Hisham, are you now wishing you listen to me and to Allah? Do you not wish that you obeyed me and Allah? I pray to Allah that you don't have to face regrets in the afterlife. May Allah make us regret in this life for all the sins we committed. Because regret now helps, regret then hurts. Regret now helps. Regret then hurts. They spoke to him. Then the Prophet says, do you not wish that you listened? How many times our parents taught us, do this which is right. How many times our teachers taught us that which is right. How many times that our imams and scholars taught us that which is right. We pray to Allah that we don't get told in the grave or afterlife, do you not wish that you listened? May Allah forgive us and guide us. Say Ameen. So then he said the second statement. First one, do you not wish that you obeyed Allah and His Messenger? Then look what he says. Two more parts. He says, as for us, the promise of our Lord has been fulfilled. What promise? If we work hard, we do everything we can, plus trust Allah equals victory. Allah's promise came. We are content, happy, and in tranquility. Then the last part he told the dead people. Now, you know, the companions are what? Like, what is happening? Like, you're talking to dead people. We'll address them. Then the Prophet said, as for you, O dead Quraysh, Abu Jahl, have you seen what Allah promised of punishment, of now being tortured? This comes to prove once again, there is punishment before resurrection. You see that? Do you not see what Allah has promised that you will see if you disbelieve and disobey? Umar says, Ya Rasulullah, you're talking to dead bodies that have no souls in them. He says, Ya Umar, these dead people hear me as clear as you. But the only thing, لا يستطيعون أن ينطقون أو كما قال, but they cannot respond to me. May Allah forgive us and grant us guidance, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Then the believers, brothers and sisters, grabbed some of the prisoners of war whom they were able to chain up. About 70 of them, did not kill them. They were able just to lock them up. And they went back all the way to Medina. People in Medina did not believe they won. Even the Muslims were like, real? Like, I know Allah can do everything. But we actually won. They could not. Someone came, a believer came, says we won. And they said, okay. The narration says, we did not believe until we saw the army coming. No, until we saw the army coming with the prisoners of war. Imagine, here's the guy that tortured you. We got him. Back in Mecca. Can you imagine that? You know who was with them? Uqba bin Abi Mu'it. The one who threw that filth on the Prophet. Remember? He's there. But Ali could not handle. And there's nothing wrong with it. Ali, finished him. Prisoner of war. Prisoner. Your prisoner. No. And the Prophet did not comment against that. This is war. It's fine. Allahu Akbar. Right? He clapped. Allahumma barak. Alhamdulillah. What will we do to the prisoners of war? You have to get ransomed. Someone has to pay for your freedom. Big amount of money. There was a lot of discussion happening. That was the end action plan. So some had to pay. Some family members came from Mecca. Here's the money for this guy, my relative. Who, yeah. So the payment is gone. Come here, you know, you loser. Come here. Okay, you cost us all that stress and money, and he didn't even do anything. Come here, right? Right, and whatever they said. And maybe I'm being very gentle, by the way, right? And then, but what about the people who have no relatives who can pay off their freedom? Their freedom comes in a payment. In which sort? Teach Muslim children how to write. The importance of education, once again. May Allah allow us to be people who are able to read and write, and people who are able to read and write the Qur'an. And may Allah allow us to be able to read it, apply it, and understand it, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, Jibreel alayhi salam comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jibreel says, Ya Muhammad, what is the status of the believers who participated in Badr? What's their status in your eyes? He said, the ones who showed up to Badr, أَفْضَلِ Muslimin, they are the best Muslims. And by the way, when the war of gains came, the Prophet gave a share of the war to who? To Uthman bin Affan and the people who wanted to show up, but some obstacle perhaps came, and Uthman was among the very few companions who stayed in Medina, yet was given a share, because remember, he stayed behind just because his wife Ruqayya, the daughter of the Prophet ﷺ, was sick. So then the Prophet says, these people who came are the best believers. Jibreel says, and the angels who showed up are the best angels. One of the greatest men that joined, now brothers and sisters, we want to talk about something that heals the wounds. I know you have some wounds of sitting and sweating, but ya akhi, we spoke about battle. It's okay, bear a little bit of sweat. Some story to heal the wounds of war. One of the single men, he was single, okay, was being pushed to get married, but he did not have much money. Who is that man? Who is he getting to propose to? We'll see, inshallah, after the break, inshallah.